I'm happy to share my research with you today. So today I really want to answer three questions. Okay. What is suffering? Because if we do not know what it is, it's difficult to have a science of suffering. And secondly, if it is more controversial, is that suffering, why is suffering the foundation for flourishing? Finally, we're going to talk about how we can turn suffering into flourishing. So the first question I want to answer is that, why do I study the positive psychology of suffering? Because that's not a very profitable area. I don't advise any young people to choose that area, because the positive psychology of happiness is usually the most popular course on campuses. If I offer a course on how to suffer, probably very few people will take that course. Now, suffering, here's the starting point. Suffering is a fact of life. That no, it's inevitable, it's inescapable. The key is that how we respond to suffering make us either bitter or better. So we all realize the bi-directionality of suffering, but all signs tend to focus on suffering is bad. Suffering is bad for your health, bad for your happiness. But I want to challenge you to think about that suffering can be good for us. Okay? Can be good for us. Okay? Now, why on earth did I choose to study suffering? It partly had to do with my upbringing. I grew up through the Second World War. I grew up through civil war. I was a refugee in Hong Kong, a poor student in Canada. So ever since my childhood, I just naturally asked, why do bad people prosper and good people suffer? How can I find happiness when life is so hard? So that's a natural question for me to ask, because I remember when I was 3 years old, the Japanese people kicked us all out, took over our house, and the communists come, took over our everything. So I said that we were so hard to make a decent living. Why do I have to suffer? Okay. But this is an ancient question. Job asked that, and Solomon asked that. Here's what I've learned, okay? I don't know how about North America. When I was a child in public school, we were taught, if you do not suffer, you cannot be a fully functioning human being. 不吃苦,不成人. In other words, if you want to be the best, you'll suffer the most. So the idea of suffering is necessity for survival and for success is ingrained in your brain. Okay? So I'm grateful for that kind of training that allow me to survive. And also my animal learning has put a point. Now, I have no time to share with you my exciting animal studies, but I've done all kinds of studies. The main finding is this: moderate and unpredictable intermittent suffering in animal, even when they're young, make them smarter, more resilient, more competitive. So now more recent research with humans show the same thing. Small and moderate amount of suffering in childhood, in early experience, actually contribute to the people's resilience and well-being. Okay? And my aging research showed the same thing. People who age well, okay, who are successful and healthy in aging, most of them can report the past experience of overcoming suffering. You see, all my research, I have kinds of data to support the idea that some kind of suffering in the past is much better than no suffering. The worst can do to anyone. The worst can do is shelter them from any suffering. That the worst can do to anyone, okay? They are more scientific reason for my study. Now, everybody study happiness. But do you realize, many people never thought about that. Do you realize the actual pursuit of happiness is a major source of suffering? Think about that. No more and more research supporting that, okay? Now, I want to be happy. That's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong about that. Everybody wants to be happy, okay? Some people say, oh, I don't want to be famous or rich. I just want to be an ordinary person, free from stress and worry. I just want to be happy. Now think about the logic. I just want to be an ordinary person and be a happy person, free from stress and worry. Is it possible? Is it possible for any human being, doesn't matter if we're ordinary or not ordinary, it's not possible for us to be. You know why? But we are our worst enemies. All the suffering, it comes within us. Happiness depends on the quality of our inner life, the quality of our thought, the purity of your heart, the nature of aspiration, your head full of junk, full of selfishness. It doesn't matter how you study a sign of happiness. You're still miserable. Okay, the next thing. All I want is to marry someone who will make me happy. Have you heard that before? If any woman tell you that, you better run. Because it's not possible for any man to make a woman happy if she is miserable inside her. So anyone end up in divorce. It's simply not possible to depend on another person to make you happy if you are not happy with yourself. It's impossibility. Only you can make you happy. Okay. So why am I so miserable? With all the knowledge and all the wealth to make people happy, but so many miserable people. I don't know about you. I have not met a single person who's not miserable. Whether rich or poor, or highly educated, you know, like, oh, I have so many clients, you know. I'll give you an example. Yeah? One of my clients is a famous medical doctor. He is probably the top five, you know, in his area. His wife is also a medical doctor. And fame, money, and a good wife. You know. But he couldn't see me because he's miserable. Why? Because he falls in love with his attractive young research assistant. Did it happen in Harvard? I'm sure it happened in Harvard too. So he torn between loyalty to his wife and desire for this young assistant. Didn't know why. Because all those 30 years, he spent all his energy and time to pursue medicine, to pursue success. He achieved that, but he had ignored the other part of his life, his intimacy with his wife. So both of them coexist as two colleagues. So there's a lacking of intimacy and love. So now there's a vacuum. So therefore, this young lady coming in fill that spot. But the result is he found himself in a horrible situation. So often, one moment of pleasure leads to a lifelong regret and suffering. So he got caught. He didn't know how to do with his wife. He didn't know how to do with his young attractive system. So I'll give you a case out of the case. I have another case where a young woman got a graduate degree in AI, artificial intelligence, got a good paying job, yet on a scale of 1 to 10, to what extent are you suffering, she scored 9.5. She's healthy, got good caring home, got good paying job. She's in her late 20s. And what is suffering? Guys like her, she's not interested in. But the guy who's interested in is married. So her main suffering is her loneliness. But her loneliness is because she can't not accept herself. She thinks she's too fat. So therefore, try to calm, relieve her suffering, she keep on binging and vomiting, binging and purging. So it's productive. You keep on binging, you get fat. So she can't live with herself, she can't accept herself. So her suffering is not caused by any external event or caused by some other people. Her suffering is because she cannot accept herself. I can give you cases of the cases. The pursuit of happiness can lead you to misery unless you know how to live yourself, how to be at peace with yourself. So that's why I say, you know, from my experience as a clinical psychologist, and I discovered that most people suffering because their basic human need for mental health is not met. What a basic need? We need to have connection with other people, love. We need to connect with people. We also need hope. We need to have hope for a better future, hope for developing ourselves, hope to improve ourselves, hope in striving towards a future goal. You do not have a sense of purpose, you'll be miserable. And finally, the most overlooked area that we need to connect it with God. What do we call it? The heaven, the sky God, ancestor, cosmos, nature. Whatever we call it, we're hardwired to believe and to worship, to pray for protection. So if we don't have these three connections, we're like fish out of water. We are made for, so people suffer, but they're so concerned about possess material things, possessions. fame, power, ignoring the basic human need. So that's why you pursue happiness and ignore your basic mental, psychological, spiritual need, you suffer. Well, if you don't realize that another sort of suffering is to deny and avoid suffering. Lots of cases in mental illness, it will be sort of trying to run away from suffering. The more you avoid suffering, avoid your problem, the worse you get. If you do why? Your problem just grow bigger, bigger, bigger. The monster become bigger and bigger until it comes swallow you. So unless you learn to face the monster, the monster, the evil demon will always cause you trouble. That's why so many successful people got derailed in their career. Because they never spend time to deal with their inner monsters. Okay. So that's why the need to study something. Now the second question, that the first question now, what is suffering? Well, I have demonstrated suffering is more complex. Suffering is the greatest mystery in human experience. Job asked the question, Solomon asked the question, the wisest people in the world have asked the question, what is suffering is a bigger, more complex question than what is happiness, okay? So I already demonstrate, explain to you, the many things we think are good for us, actually bad for us. And something we do think is important, like belief in God or belief to other people, we do think that is important, but that is important for us for lack of suffering. So that's why if you study suffering as an abstract concept, it don't go very far. That is the recent paper with Richard about suffering in Indonesia. If you make suffering, you don't know how young people are going through there. They're facing all kinds of natural disasters, a corrupt government. People are miserable. Because of the situation, you have geography, because of the politics. So unless you think about suffering people or think about your own suffering, then you do not understand what suffering is. Suffering is not an abstract concept. You don't go very far, but it's just treating it as an abstract concept. Now, I struggle with trying to develop something to measure different kinds of suffering. I hope that Richard can help me out. We'll continue to work on this area. To begin with, maybe we simply talk about different kinds of suffering in a 2x2 contingency table. The most common kind will be the external uncontrollable. Natural disaster, pandemic, an unjust system. So that is beyond individual control. That a little guy didn't much can do, but at least can do some little good in our little corner. So that area, yeah. The external controllable, that is more manageable because a lot of people resign to say, because they find their work is toxic, okay? And also many people are in an abusive relationship. So at least you can terminate, so they do something for it. And safe neighborhood, they move out if they can. So external is not our major source of suffering for most people. unless you're born in dire poverty, living in a war-torn country. So people in North America, external suffering probably the least concern. Now, top of internal, the uncontrollable part is also a least concern because our medical science is so good. So most disease is treatable. And disability, we also have all kinds of assistance. And hormonal change is part of life. So that's not the main problem. The main problem is this area. This area. All kind of bad habits we grew up from childhood. Laziness and bad attitude. So bad attitude is hostile with people, don't trust anyone, and selfishness. Here, this is our problem. Our problem is here, the two cases I mentioned earlier. Why don't you want to be happy? You want to be happy, it does not justify you to hurt other people. Oh, what's wrong with me? I don't want to be happy. You want to be happy, it doesn't mean that you can manipulate and exploit other people. You want to be happy, doesn't mean that you can steal other people's credit, exploit other people. Sooner or later, or sin will catch up with us. You cannot really get away. Until you numb your conscience. Your conscience will not let you go. So here is our mental suffering. And unless we take care of that, we can never be happy. A foolproof problem, the suffering. Even when everything is going well, like my other example, you know, it's a young woman. She got everything going for her. Oh, she wants a dream guy that can make her happy. She cannot find a person, and she suffered intensely. A wise person creates happiness, even when he had all the problems. A wise man can be happy in worse situations. A fool can be miserable, even have everything. So what really matters is the quality of, again, the quality of your mind. The quality of your heart. Trying to satisfy carnal desires will mass misery. Some rich people are the most miserable. The legend of Dr. Foster's. You have many people like Foster in Harvard, okay? Want to be smartest. Want to be the most famous, want to have the most happiness. They sell their soul to the devil. Want to be happy, the most famous. I see many miserable people like that. Sell their soul, sell their integrity, sell their family to be famous. On top of the individual, there are also existential crises, you know, pandemic, climate change. So in other words, whether from the individual angle or from humanity angle, we just can't get away with suffering. Just forget about trying to get away. It's not possible. It's not possible. Okay. So what do we do? maybe we change our mind. We can't change the world. We can't change other people. Maybe the disease can change. We can change our mind. Maybe we start thinking to understand. Maybe suffering is our best teacher. Suffering is our best friend. Suffering teaches us how to live, how to die. Maybe the best way to find myself is to lose myself. It's a paradox now. When we're willing to suffer, when we're willing to suffer, willing to sacrifice, then you find happiness. When you're willing to empty yourself, when you're willing to let go, then like a cup, then you can be full. So happiness is paradoxical. Suffering is paradoxical. You won't be happy, you end up miserable. You will not afraid, you're willing to voluntary suffering. You're willing to suffer for other people, willing to suffer for your loved one, willing to suffer for a good cause. Then happiness comes to you. So you have changed your mind from vertical to from horizontal thinking, me, possession, get more things, to vertical. How to please God, how to serve other people. How to understand suffering. What would make this mega shift in our mindset, then the light begins to come in. So suffering is the essential suffering because there's two values, okay? Usually suffering is involving a moment of real awakening. That's why we see suffering is a portal to heaven. Suffering is the gateway to flourishing. Suffering is the foundation for flourishing because of these four values. The first value is diagnostic value. Just like pain, tell you something wrong in your body. Similarly, suffering tells us that our life is out of balance. There's something wrong in our life. That we need to make some fundamental changes. A few days ago, Richard knows about that. I keep on taking on requests for interview, requests for speed, requests of. I keep on taking on as if I'm. As if I was Superman, that I can handle anything. As if I was still living in prime. But my body can't take anymore. So a few days ago, I just shut down. I just paralyzed. I even could not breathe. It's horrifying. I told my wife that if I give up everything, I still could not breathe, I take me to the hospital. So I just ignore my age. And I keep on taking on things. I can handle it. I can handle it. I said, I don't worry. I don't hurry. Jesus is my friend. So tell myself that. But that's so self-deception. And God's not save me. If I ignore my help. Oh, Jesus, take care of me. He's my friend. But he didn't. I collapsed just a few days ago. Diagnosis. Curative means that you start making changes. So I had to let medicines go. Now I'm back to health. So thank God for suffering, for pain. Because now you're making changes. Maybe spend more time with your spouse, spend more time with the children, or spend more time with your parents, a small time in quality relationship. And redemptive value simply my friend McAdams think about the redemptive life. And many people in their middle age, in their life review, discover that they've done some, they regret for the wrong thing they've done. So they say, well, if I don't make amends, I do not change my way of life, it'll be too late. So they began to live differently, to live the second time as if the first time they've done it wrong. So life is redemptive. The best human stories, not a person is happy all the time. The most human story, best human story, is a redemptive story. The best movie, the best novels, they all have to do with redemption. Okay? So if you are redeemed, if you have changed, something has transformed your value, make you a better person. Wow. Unless you become a different person, all the skills, all the activity that make you happy will not make you happy. Trust me, okay? I live old enough to know that. I have many clients who are very successful. Very successful. But something's wrong with their heart condition. They don't have they have a tormented conscience. The conscience tormented them. They're broken relationships. The life is out of balance. They're chasing after the wrong thing. So that's why the last point I want to make is how to turn suffering into flourishing. Here are three principles. The first principle is very ancient wisdom, Chinese ancient wisdom, polarity, but also good science. All things in nature exist in polarity. You want to know Chinese beyond that? Everything is science. Newton's basic principle of physics, action, reaction. Okay? For the physics of chemistry, inhibition, excitation, day and night, good and evil, everything exists in polarity. Okay? So in life, good and evil, happiness and sadness is natural. There are two sides of the same coin. You can't just study happiness, ignore suffering. That's not possible. That's why it's dead end. Study happiness by itself is dead end. After 20 years, we're just as miserable and selfish as before. There's no change. So, the new science is how to benefit from this opposite. When you're happy, and Chinese saying is that, 乐极生悲, that means when you're extremely happy, something bad will happen. And Charlie Brown said the same thing, Charlie Brown, right? I don't want to be too happy because something bad happened to me. So when you're very happy, very successful, think about don't be proud, because next step you might fall, you might fail. When you're at the bottom, don't despair, because you're no way to go but going up. So but think about polarity, it helps you to maintain a proper balance. You only look at the positive, go astray, too arrogant, too optimistic, too confident. A lot of research has shown that if too proud, too confident, that leads to misery. If you focus on the negatives, then you got depressed, anxious, is not good for you. The happy medium. Aristotle, Confucius, they all talk about happy medium. Think about the opposite. When happy, it's the opposite. When sad, it's the opposite. So you need to hold two opposite in two hands. Then you'll be able to find the right way, how to navigate between two opposites. And then you'll be able to rise above the tension, transcend your limitation, transcend the opposite, transcend the negative, transcend the conflict. You're able to transcend. Then you find a balance and peace. So inner peace and balance is due to, as a result of considering the polarity, navigate a balance and rise above it. Okay? So that's why I say suffering is the foundation of flourishing, because you do not include the suffering element. You only work with half of the whole. You can, there's always something lacking. You cannot know the truth. When you see we need darkness to see the light. We need sadness to see happy. All the good things in life are on the other side of suffering. If you want to, you are not prepared to suffer. Forget about being happy. Just forget it. Forget about being successful, being happy. Forget about being having a happy marriage. Forget about having good children. Unless you're not willing to accept suffering, accept fear, you end up in trouble. Here is from Carl Jung, and we need to think of roots into dark soil of suffering in order to grow and flourish. That is a new sign of suffering. Not only for your suffering, tolerate suffering, get your own suffering, but actually stick your root in suffering. Go deeper, broader. I have a lot of research on that. You go deeper and broader, then you grow taller and spread your branches, spread your leaves and flourish. The new science of flourishing consists of the dialectic process of thinking one's roots and spreading your branches. That's a secret. You can't have that without that. You can't have this without this, okay? A prototype of voluntary suffering. That Jesus said, I come that you may have life and have life more abundantly. Jesus show us how to have abundant life. It's not a broad way. Not a broad way. The broad way leads to destruction. Pursuing happiness and success is a broad way that leads to destruction. But a narrow way of voluntary suffering, of carrying the cross and follow him. When we arm our mind with not a fear of suffering and willing to suffer, to glorify God, to serve other people, then we find inner peace, we find happiness. I show you an example how to live fully, how to live abundantly. That means go deeper, go higher. I'm not going to preach for you, okay? Sorry about that. The principle of polarity, right? Fortune and suffering are two sides of the same coin. Now, say the mental about the five permanent, Think about that. Can you have relationship with your suffering? Can you have meaningful work with your suffering? Can you have comprehensive with your suffering? It's not possible. So you can work yourself out with that. If you really want to flourish, you have to embrace suffering. That is summary, yin yang. Flourishing depends on optimal balance between yin and yang, between negative and positive, between everything. Okay? The key to find balance. A new paradigm of flourishing through suffering. Now, the old way, fight or flight or freeze, the old way. It doesn't work. That's for animals. Who do you fight? I can fight a conquer animal. In one society, in a digital world, who will fight? Who's the enemy? Fight. How do you escape from yourself? How do you escape from your greed? How do you escape from your own ambition? How do you escape from your lust for a woman? How? So fight and flight doesn't work. You can't fight and flight. And freeze doesn't work either. You're frozen. So a new paradigm is not fine, but approach system, awareness system, or coordinate this through pause. Wu Wei. Pause means that we're lost. Pause. When you are confused, pause. When you're stressed out, pause. Meditate, go to prayer room, calm down, meditate, pray, think. Most of my ideas come from prayer. I spend at least an hour a day in the morning meditating and praying. Wu Wei, doing nothing. No action, doing nothing. So that is before fight, flight, and freeze. Freeze is the worst option. But here, Wu Wei, pause, is the key to happiness and success. Spend some time. Reflect on how you're doing. Reflect on your life goals. Is that how you want to live? Is that it? And reflect about what God wants you to do in life. What really matters. And accept life, not worth living. You need to pause to accept your own life. To reflect on your own life. When you able to pause a simple way, you pause for 3 seconds. The first second, ask yourself, what's happening? The orienting reflex. What's happening? The animal do that. What's happening? But we have a cortex that we understand the thing. What does it mean? What do you mean? What the meaning of the situation? See cortex now. The third level, your conscience. What the right thing to do. See? What is it? What's happening? Second. What does it mean? Third. What should I do? You ask yourself these three questions, when you pause, more likely you'll do the right thing because you go through this. Who wait, just pause. What the rest of you do? What should I do? Then when you respond, if you go through this pausing, the reflection, then suffering will lead to flourishing and personal growth. If you react instinctively, naturally, you fight or flight, you'll not be successful, you'll not be happy. So here, in a way, you know, facing the present moment, accept life as it is, a clear understanding of your core value, your true self, and do all things with equanimity. It's a common practice. Life is full of suffering and sacrifice is painful, but my reason for living and striving is stronger. That's why if your reason for living, then suffering is no longer suffering. I'm willing to suffer because I'm suffering for a reason. And Frankl discovered that truth a long time ago. If there's suffering, there's a meaning for suffering, then suffering is no longer suffering. So I'm called a second wave past psychology because it incorporates suffering. So true happiness come inner peace, contentment, not optimal excitement. Now, research, kind of research, we all know that. Most people want calmness, not excitement. And my friend, you guys know Tim Lomas. He also said that calmness is the essence of happiness. So calmness belongs to this area, spiritual happiness. Chironic happiness, I come from Philippians chapter 4. Paul says, rejoice, I say rejoice. That is the word charisma, the gift. Spiritual happiness. And Jesus said, in this world you have trouble. Blessed are you when you're persecuted. Blessed are those who mourn. Sadness is better than laughter in power. Don't say the same thing. So we have been pursuing this. But suffering is very disruptive of hedonic and your demonic happiness. But chironic happiness is most resistant to disruption and to trauma. You can rejoice anytime. You can have chironic happiness anytime, even in the worst of time. So if you accept that, then you'll be able to avoid toxic. To be able to have a resilient mind to face a tough mind, resilience to face whatever happens around the world, whatever happened to you. So this is a complete story about my second wave past psychology, including suffering and reaching a happen in hell. You have to go to physical hell to heaven. And then you'll be able to benefit more people. Here's my institute. I hope you can join us. Okay, here's the end of my talk.